Clerk to read the motion, please.
That this Assembly, noting the failure of the attempt at area-based planning for schools in the previous mandate, expresses its concern at the proposals contained in Providing Pathways Draft Strategic Area Plan for School Provision 2017-2020, believes that schools in rural areas will be most at risk from the proposals, calls on the Minister of Education to detail what rural proofing measures were undertaken during the development of the proposed area plan, and further calls on the Minister to introduce legislation for a statutory presumption against the closure of rural schools, similar to the protections already in place in England and Scotland.
Thank you. I call Sandra Overend to move the motion.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker, and it is with great concern that the Ulster Unis and the SLB bring forward this afternoon's motion to the floor of the Chamber. The draft strategic area plan for school provision, as put forward by the Minister of Education, is flawed. First of all, it is concerning that it is based on the same sustainable schools policy which underpinned the previous area plan, which was called into serious disrepute by the Public Accounts Committee only a few months ago. It shows a complete failure on the part of the Minister to seriously address the issues facing primary and secondary schools in Northern Ireland, not least of which the funding crisis, but importantly systemic problems with underachievement and educational inequalities. Instead, it threatens struggling schools with closure, it targets rural communities and creates a sense of panic in the school system which takes the focus away from children in the classroom. Mr. Deputy Speaker, our first major concern is that it is based on bad statistics. In an answer to a written question by the Ulster Unionist Party leader, the Minister had indicated that 439 primary schools and 104 post-primary schools will be in budget deficit by 2019. And according to the Sustainable Schools Policy, this is a measure of sustainability. Firstly, while all these schools are showing a budget deficit in 2019, 11% of the primary schools on the list are actually showing clear evidence that they are reducing their deficit. So to put them on this list is particularly unfair. Perhaps a little more time and support would allow these schools to get back. Another important issue is that 80% of the post-primary schools in this list and 88% of primary schools are in rural areas. 88%, Mr. Deputy Speaker. What are these areas to do if their school is attacked with school closures? Where will these children go? Thousands of children will be dispersed into alternative schools. Where will they be taught? Out in the tarmac? The consultation document states itself that the education budget has been unable to provide the level of investment in the existing estate that is required, and this new plan will change nothing. Unless the Minister has a few billion in his back pocket to fund capital development, I do not understand how this is to be orchestrated. And what savings are to be made? The plan itself states that 80% of the budget given to schools is used for staff salaries, but the same amount of teachers are needed to teach the same amount of pupils. To my knowledge, the only saving that may be made is on the small schools support factor, which sits at 3.82% of the aggregated schools budget. To be honest, the Minister is fooling no one if he is going to insist this measly sum makes the dispersal of thousands of children worthwhile. A second concern, and I've said this before, any area plan should be proposed with gusto, highlighting fabulous opportunities that should be forthcoming, educational advantages that should be realised. How, as the Minister has suggested, will the closure of schools improve the quality of education? We still have no indication of this. It is simply presumed that bigger schools are better schools and smaller schools are inferior. I would suggest that there are many teachers and principals and indeed parents and pupils who will be offended by this statement. What the Minister does suggest in the plan is that we continue to face some challenges, and indeed there are 8 listed in the consultation document. I'm not in disagreement with him on the challenges listed. Indeed, I could add a few myself. What I'm not clear on is how exactly this proposal, which would see the decimation of rural schools, would solve these problems. Rather than actually addressing the funding crisis, the Minister is using it to drive his own agenda of school closures. He is creating a state of panic and fear in rural areas where parents are wondering, will the school my children attend still be around in 3, 4 or 5 years? If a school is labelled unsustainable, as the Minister has done, this drives parents and pupils away in fear and plunges the school into a further state of crisis. Mr Deputy Speaker, legislation such as that we are proposing was passed in England in 2006, in Scotland in 2014, and in Wales, the current Education Secretary just last week announced changes to the School Organisation Code, which will see the inclusion of a presumption against rural school closures. The rest of the UK has recognised the special place rural schools have in their communities. They recognise that pupils in rural areas deserve the same opportunities as children in other areas, and the challenges they face, such as small pupil numbers, budget and resource pressures, and greater difficulty in recruiting teachers, head teachers and staff. Rather than punishing rural areas with threats, fear and school closures, the Minister needs to work with schools to find innovative ways of ensuring that a quality education can be delivered in rural areas. In Wales, 78 rural schools have closed since 2010, which is approximately 20% of the school stock in these areas. Many argue that the presumption against rural school closures has come too late, as some children as young as 4 and 5 are travelling up to an hour to reach the nearest school. Now, I don't want to see that happening in Northern Ireland. I would like to see children in rural areas protected against this, and a statutory presumption against rural school closures will go some distance in ensuring that this takes place. The legislation in England has been in place since 2006 under Section 15(4) of the Education and Inspections Act. This legislation does not mean that a rural school will never close, but the case for closure should be strong, and a proposal must be clearly in the best interests of educational provision in the area. When producing a proposal, the proposer must carefully consider the likely effect of the closure of the school in the local community, educational standards at the school, and the likely effect on standards at neighbouring schools, the availability and likely cost of transport to other schools, any increase in the use of motor vehicles, which is likely to result from the closure of the school, and the likely effects of any such increase, and any alternatives to the closure of the schools. These are simple checks and balances, Mr Deputy Speaker, that can help ensure that closing a rural school is really the only option available, and that all other options and costs to the community have been considered. Indeed, in 10, 20 or 30 years' time, when many of us are long gone, and there will be another education minister with his own agenda, perhaps another strategic area plan, a legislative measure such as the examples we have suggested will give long-term transparency and accountability around decisions being made on rural schools. Putting simple checks and balances in place to ensure all options have been considered. At the end of the day, this is the education of our children we have in our hands. Indeed, the Minister has more responsibility than any of us, and I hope he is not afraid of accountability. Is he afraid that a measure such as this will expose flaws in his agenda? If so, he has serious questions he needs to ask of his proposals. If he is not afraid, then he'll have no issue putting protections in place for those living in rural areas. In conclusion, Mr Deputy Speaker, I hope this afternoon's debate can be a constructive one. We all want an improved education system for our children. Mature decisions need to be made with regard to planning for the future. Mature decisions, not masked in fear. I propose the motion.
Yeah. I call Lord Morrill to move Amendment number 1.
Thank you, Deputy Speaker. I beg to move the amendment standing in my name and that of my colleagues on the Education Committee, namely Carol Lockhart and Philip Logan. Deputy Speaker, I don't think there's a single member of this House who would disagree with the sentiment in the amendment which states that every pupil, regardless of where they live, both rural and urban, should have access to quality education in a viable and sustainable school to give our children and young people the best start in life. I am certain every one of us could put our hands up for that. Where we differ, of course, is how that might be best achieved. I and my party, the DUP, feel that the most effective way of achieving this is through an effective area planning process involving managing authorities and sectoral support bodies, as stated in our amendment. We do, of course, acknowledge this must be done in a most sensitive way, particularly for isolated communities. Mr. Deputy Speaker, that is why we are calling on the Minister of Education today to commit to bringing forward a strategic small schools initiative to ensure accessibility to a quality education, particularly for isolated communities. Small rural schools are and have been a vital part of life in Northern Ireland, and indeed they are the heartbeat of these communities. Alas, over the past 40 years, many of our small rural schools have disappeared. As a councillor for some 40 years, I can well remember many battles fought in an attempt to retain these schools, but due to lack of children attending, some of these rural schools were not sustainable. Indeed, school closures were not confined to rural schools, as some of our village schools were impacted on as well. Deputy Speaker, I am not saying that a school, either urban or rural, should never be closed. To adopt that position is just burying one's head in the sand. However, what I am saying is that before a school is closed, in particular a rural school, all the issues must be carefully considered, not least the direct and indirect impact such a decision would have on that particular community. Rural schools play a key role in local communities, particularly where small, isolated communities live alongside one another. Such schools are often the local point for communities, and their proposed closure causes concern among the people who live there. Removing the school out of a village will indeed leave a big hole in that community. Rural proofing must be carried out before a rural school is considered for closure, and certainly before it is published, as adverse publicity could impact on a school. Many jobs can be lost as a result of a school closing. Teachers, local caretakers, groundspeople, school secretaries, classroom assistants, bus drivers, sometimes these are part-time posts, but nevertheless important to the post holder and to our rural communities. All of these positions play a vital and important part in our rural schools. Deputy Speaker, I represent a very rural constituency. Indeed, I think I'm right when I say it is the largest in the UK geographically. It has to be said, during the long years of the Troubles, many families living in border areas were compelled to leave their homes for security reasons. This impacted on children attending rural, isolated schools, and I have no doubt the terrorist campaign which was waged was directly responsible for the closure of some of our rural primary schools, in particular along the Fermanagh, Tyrone and Armagh border areas. Deputy Speaker, it is also true that some of the teaching staff in isolated rural areas were brutally murdered. We should all reflect on the impact these serious incidents had on families and children who were connected to these schools right across the whole community. My party leader, indeed, was also caught up in a bomb attack on the school bus she was travelling on when was on the school run. I asked you, what mindset was at work when a school bus is targeted by terrorists? Hopefully this sort of activity is now behind us, and we have truly moved into an era where such incidents are never, never again repeated. We must have an efficient, effective, acceptable and trustworthy strategic area plan, one which this Assembly and our community has total respect for and confidence in. It should be the basis for educating all of the children from our community, regardless of their social, political, religious or intellectual ability. It should be all-encompassing and designed to ensure no one is left behind. This, I accept, is a huge challenge, but hopefully one this Assembly, the Minister, and I believe he is, and Education Authority are up for. I have said earlier that I want to see an education provision where no child is left behind. This is something I most sincerely believe in, and this includes, in my books, those who may be on the margins. It has to be reaching out to the less privileged, if that is the correct terminology to use. It must be all-inclusive to include post-primary, primary and special sectors. Mr. Deputy Speaker, I am convinced if this is achieved, then a massive step in the right direction will have been taken. I think we should all be looking today for an assurance from the Minister that no pupil will be disadvantaged because of the location of their school. and that rural communities will receive equality of treatment when it comes to accessing education. That meets their needs and prepares them for their future. Regarding rural proofing, I look forward to hearing what the Minister has to say when he comes to speak around this important facet in taking education provision forward. Deputy Speaker, if I may, I would impress upon the Minister that should the occasion arise that if and when a school is assessed as unsustainable in terms of numbers, consideration will be given to its retention as it may be vital for the area. I don't for one moment underestimate the challenges our rural schools are facing, but I am persuaded with the right approach, alongside responsible and creative thinking, our rural communities can enjoy the same effective delivery of education as their urban counterparts.
He'll agree with me that I find it strange for the two parties, the SDLP and Ulster Unionists, come to this House and talk about legislation and then in the same vein talk about treating everybody fairly. When they were in charge, they introduced Article 64 of the Education Order 1989, which gives a duty on the department, which we are now encumbered with, which has to promote and facilitate Irish medium and integrated schools. So therefore, when it comes to actually dealing with schools, the Minister cannot act because of the way they were shackled by these two parties whenever they signed up to the Belfast Agreement.
Yeah. Well, unfortunately, inconsistencies are not a new phenomenon in this House. And I clearly understand what the member has said and thank him for it. Deputy Speaker, but I have to continue and state that I am encouraged that Minister Weir, since he took up his post, has visited many of our schools, and he will have witnessed firsthand the superb job principals, teachers and others do. All of them take particular pride in their schools and give of their best in ensuring that under their charge, their children are getting the best start in their education. School funding under the Common Funding Scheme, CFS, is very often a matter of debate. I am of the opinion the Minister should examine the CFS to ensure it is fit for purpose and that schools are being adequately funded to deliver the best possible outcomes. Our rural schools are vital for the sustainability of rural communities, and I am confident this will be emphasised, I suspect, by most, if not all, who participate in this debate today, whether they're in favour of the motion or the DUP amendment. Mr. Deputy Speaker, in conclusion, can I say I believe the one thing that we all agree on is we want the best possible outcomes for our children and young people, and as they prepare themselves for a very competitive world. I trust that as a result of today's debate, we can go forward united in our determination to achieve these outcomes. Thank you.
I call Kelly Armstrong to move amendment number 2.
Thank you, Deputy Speaker. I rise today to move Alliance's amendment number 2 for this debate on rural schools. On behalf of the Alliance Party, I confirm that we're unable to support the original motion because it calls for the protection of the school estate, buildings, rather than what is best for our rural children. Mr. Speaker, I live in a rural community. As a child, I attended a rural school. I have a child who attends a rural who attended a rural primary school, and she's now at a rural post-primary school. As a rural dweller, and indeed as an MLA who serves the largely rural constituency of Strangford, I have fought and continue to fight for service to be located in rural areas. I believe in the sustainability of rural communities. During question time, I've questioned various ministers to ask what they're doing to ensure rural proofing applies to policies. However, I cannot support the ongoing provision of a school in a rural area if it is not meeting the educational needs of our children. The official opposition motion calls for the retention of schools in rural areas, but doesn't once mention the educational opportunities for children. I want the best for our children, and that isn't sitting in a largely empty room in an underfunded, declining education system, struggling to survive in order, not just at the moment, struggling to survive in order to keep buildings open. As the Chief Inspector has said, all learners need and indeed are entitled to the highest quality of education and training if Northern Ireland is to aspire to being world class. I believe we have excellent capacity within and across sectors of education and training that will, if appropriately applied, help us to meet and resolve the challenges we face in order to be even better. In some cases, the future of rural schools are called into question because the numbers attending are so low that the school is simply no longer viable. The number of teaching staff is affected, and children no longer have access to an education system that will enhance their skills, talents and abilities. It is not good enough to state that a rural school must be protected. The motion calls simply for the protection of the school state and doesn't mention the very heart of this issue: what is going to be better for rural children. The chief, not just at the moment. In the Chief Inspector's report of 2014 to 2016, she states in relation to rural schools in Part 33, there's also a small difference in inspection outcomes between smaller and larger primary and post-primary schools, with larger schools tending to do better in inspections than the smallest. For primary schools, this difference only becomes meaningful at low enrolment levels, and for rural primaries, between those with less than 105 pupils and those above. I do not believe that rural children should be put at a disadvantage just because some people want to retain a building in an area. Mr Speaker, the needs of the child should come first. In the PAC report on the Department of Education, Sustainability of Schools, Recommendation 4 confirms the need for the Department to commission a review of the approved enrolment figure recorded for every school. It is extremely important that the Department has up-to-date records of the current and expected enrolment for each school. This will ensure that appropriate area-based planning is considered and positive action can be taken well in advance to support rural schools to take steps to safeguard against falling below the approved enrolment figures and the negative impact that that will have for pupils, or consider alternatives, whatever that may be. At all times, the matter must be based on a child-centred approach, not to protect a building or jobs, and this applies to schools in urban and rural areas. The PAC report recommends, in Recommendation 1, there is a transparency, consistency and clarity in decision-making based on both quantitative and qualitative data. In Recommendation 5, it again repeats that decision-making is based on robust evidence and data collection. If fact-based evidence is available, then the department, the school and the school community, including families and prospective pupils' families, will have a full picture as to why a rural school may no longer be viable. Schools, particularly primary schools, are deeply seated in the communities they serve. If evidence suggests enrolment numbers in decline, then the community must be made aware of the issue and be involved in the decision as to provide the best education for children. In Recommendation 8, it confirms the need for an engagement strategy, as the report calls it, a buying in to the process, or as I prefer, community consultation. In the Alliance Amendment, we clearly state that a proper, efficient and effective consultation with the local community is completed as part of any consideration to merge or even to close a school. The Department of Education and the Education Authority need to engage in a meaningful consultation and not just pay lip service to local communities. Local communities need to feel that they are part of the process, helping to decide what is best for their young people and what education provision they want to see in the local community. Far too often, schools hear they are being earmarked for closure without proper support from either managing authority. A one-size-fits-all model won't work. What will work in one rural community may not work in another. That's why it is vital the community is involved in any discussions about the future of education in their area. Mr Deputy Speaker, the only rural school in this country that we should give special consideration to is St Mary's Primary School in Rathlin. The reasons for supporting a primary school in Rathlin are clear. The island is cut off from mainland regularly, making it impossible for primary school-aged children to travel to and from school each day. Unlike post-primary provision, there is no boarding option for primary school-aged children in Ballycastle or the surrounding area. Therefore, it is right that we should support a primary school on Rathlin for the small numbers of children living there. The school should be protected because of its unique island setting. The original motion refers to protections against closure as used in England and Scotland. Yes, I will.
And I thank you for mentioning Rathlin in my constituency, and yes, so that the member is well aware. I welcome the fact that Rathlin has increased its intake and its numbers now to 10 pupils, and it is making progress because the local community see it as their local school, but also because social housing has been delivered in the island, and it is a good news story, and I thank the member for giving support for Rathlin.
Thank you. And what I have to say is we have to remember that that scheme, used in England and Wales for those small, isolated rural schools, was created to protect schools like our Rathlin because of the unique geographic location. We don't have areas like the Highlands and Islands of Scotland or North Yorkshire. We only have Rathlin. There are children there in Scotland and England. Children have to travel in excess of 20 miles and many, many more to get to a primary school. But I ask each and every one of us, how many schools would our children pass on a 20-mile journey from your home?
In my case, it's probably about 10 primary schools. It's not wrong for children to have to travel to school. My daughter travelled over 3 miles every day to get to her local rural primary school. Many rural children travel to school every day without that journey having a negative impact on their community. In conclusion, I agree the department should do better. Area planning decisions must be based on robust evidence and accurate data to take into account all school enrolments. The PAC report asks that following a review of enrolments, the department quantifies how much surplus places cost. As the PAC identifies, this would provide a driver for change, as it would identify how much resource could be invested more effectively in the education system. If the department concentrates on ensuring children are provided with quality education system, then it can ensure the sustainability of the school estate to allow for stabilisation of enrolment numbers and provide a wider choice for pupils in terms of educational opportunities, leisure, cultural and sporting activities. As I have said, I will not be supporting the original motion set down today. I believe in children, not buildings. As a mother, I want my child and all children to have access to the best education, and like many rural families, I am content for my child to travel to access that education. I acknowledge that the DUP has recognised in their motion the sensitivities around the provision of the school's estate, and I welcome their acknowledgement of sectoral bodies such as NICE and CNG, but this isn't about buildings and ownership of land. Hard questions need to be asked. Why are we keeping a school open, and why are we not putting the pupils' education first? But I cannot support their call for a strategic small schools initiative, as I fail to see how different that approach will be to the official opposition's position to have a statutory presumption against closure. Proper governance does not mean promising populist protection. We do need to review the school estate as outlined in the PAC and the Chief Executive's recommendations. That includes consulting with the community so that they know the impact small pupil numbers have on the educational opportunities for their children. Armed with facts, people can help to make decisions about education provision in the local area. We need to put the pupil first, not buildings, and we shouldn't be keeping a school open for the sake of it. The department must learn from the Education Training Inspectorate's reports and stop working in silos. We cannot afford to maintain the school's estate in the way it is because it is reducing opportunities for our children. Thank you.
Next year, I'm Sir Barry McAlduff. I call Barry McAlduff.
Okay. Thank you, Deputy Speaker. The first part of my contribution shall be in my role as Chair of the Education Committee, and then I'll make some comments from a party political perspective. The first thing I want to say as Chair of the Education Committee is that the primary school population is growing. The post-primary population is not growing at this time, and most of this reduction is happening in non-selective schools. And it would appear that where the focus of the department and the area planning process may lie in the time ahead will be in the direction of primary schools. Not all of it, but perhaps most of the focus stand to be corrected. In the last mandate, around 26 schools were closed. There were 14 amalgamations involving 31 schools, two-thirds of which were primaries. And the number of vacant desks reduced by just 4,000. The department had often quoted a disputed number of much higher than that. I want to say that area planning tends to raise controversial issues, but it is necessary in order to plan school provision efficiently so as to deal with demographic changes and, of course, financial challenges. Members will be aware of some problems with the past process in the last mandate, and for example, the primary school's consultation feedback took the Education Authority over 1 year to analyse. So it is not without its problems. There was uncertainty in schools. Some said that the application of sustainability indicators appeared to be inconsistent. Rural schools felt in many cases that area planning was being used to further an official agenda to close small schools. Others argued even that ETA inspections were being used by the department to undermine school sustainability and therefore lead to school closure. The original motion references presumption against closure in other jurisdictions, and I think one of these jurisdictions introduced ministerial call-in for controversial school closures, etc. This society, uniquely in these islands, already has the minister making the decision on development proposals relating to very small changes to enrolments in schools. So those are some of my comments as Education Committee Chair. And to conclude that section, the committee will want a clear statement from the minister on the way forward in relation to the small schools support factor. This is vital to the survival of primaries in rural areas with less than 105 pupils. The committee will want certainty that sustainability measures will be applied transparently and consistently to all schools. It will want confirmation that all sectors will work together so as to share educational provision efficiently. It will want to support innovative local school sharing solutions, and it will want, obviously, a process that feels fair to all sectors involved in the process, including parents with children in special schools. These are part of the process for the first time. They want assurance about the added value nature of special schools and that this will not be lost in an attempt to standardise provision. Speaking as a Sinn Féin MLA, I want to say that I'm going to say it in Irish. We're going to be supporting the DUP amendment number one, Tamujig Taku Leshun Lyasu Shin Everhain. And I want to make three concluding comments. I've asked a ministerial question, a question to the minister in writing, where I ask the minister to outline if there is a body of educational research and evidence to demonstrate or refute the case that primary schools with more than 2 year groups in a single class produce poor educational outcomes. And the minister acknowledges that that body of educational research doesn't exist. And last Friday, when I visited St Mary's Primary School in Strabane, met a group of principals. The principals there were at pains to point out that composite classes do work and produce good outcomes. Yes.
Extra minute. I suppose subsequent to that answer, there has been, in terms of mentions about the more than 2 years, there is the direct reference, I think, in paragraph 34 of the ETI report, which specifically highlights that where there is composite classes spanning more than 2 years, that can be much more challenging for the teacher and limits opportunities for children to develop socially. So there is a degree of evidence, particularly when we're talking about where it goes beyond the 2 year period.
Member's next minute.
I thank the Minister for his intervention. I do think that needed to be said because there is a contest here. You know, educationalists, the principals that I met last Friday, there was a howl of protest when that point was made to them in a provocative way to tease out their response. And I did communicate to those principals, well, you need to make the arguments and they need to be based on educational research and evidence. My final point relates to Irish medium education, particularly post-primary provision. There is a need for a second post-primary in Belfast, and there is a need for a strong Irish medium post-primary school in the North West, and Gael Colestia is shaping up to be that.
Please.
Okay, thank you.
Anish Iram, Sir Richie McPhillips. I now call Richie McPhillips.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. Mr. Speaker, as an MLA for one of the most rural of these counties, I welcome the opportunity to speak on today's motion. And needless to say, the issue of rural school closures is one that Fermanagh and South Tyrone and its people are unfortunate enough to be accustomed to. It's my view, Mr. Speaker, that the proposals put forward in the draft area plan are a direct attack on rural education provision, and the SDLP and the Ulster Unionists, the official opposition, have brought today's motion, as we know, just to let everyone else that when government consultations are launched, that decisions are already being predetermined and it's now just a case of rubber stamping them. No amount of public engagement or consideration given to the Rural Needs Act will change the fact that that's what makes debates like this today so important. Mr. Speaker, it's with deep regret that we have to bring this motion to the Assembly today. To begin with, as I would have hoped that the value of rural schools to the many communities across the North would have been self-evident to the Minister. But what is clear from the proposals put forward in the Education Authorities Providing Pathways 2017-20 plan is that rural schools are being targeted by stealth. Rural schools, Mr. Speaker, represent 55% of Northern Ireland's primary schools and 20% of post-primary schools. And needless to say, the proposals put forward by the Education Authority will greatly impact on them. They are more likely, by their nature, to have smaller classes, composite classes, and a smaller number of people attending sixth form. The current proposals, Mr Speaker, will have a devastating impact on the West, as the urbanisation of education will only serve the best interests of places like Belfast and Derry and other built-up areas, which leaves rural areas like my own to take the hit, and this cannot be allowed to happen. Mr Speaker, the Minister can be assured that I, as a representative for Fermanagh South Tyrone, will not sit back and allow the erosion of rural education in my constituency, which has been disproportionately impacted if the current plan goes ahead. Mr Speaker, I'm fully in support of increasing educational outcomes for our people, young people, whether in primary, secondary or tertiary education, when there is evidence-based policy. However, I do question, Mr Speaker, just like my opposition colleagues, the motive behind the proposed plan and whether it's really based on finance rather than educational outcomes. At the moment, the Minister has failed to show how small class numbers are impacting on educational achievement. He noted last week that there was some evidence, but failed to elaborate. Well, in preparation for today's debate, I did some research myself with others and found a very interesting study conducted in Finland, a country whose education results greatly exceeds Northern Ireland's and indeed the rest of the European Union states. Finland is in the top 10 world rankings for maths, reading and science, yet just over a quarter of their state-run schools have 50 or less students. I don't advocate the need for this number of pupils in the north, but what this proves is that there are merits in small schools and they can greatly increase educational outcomes with the right guidance and policy stemming from the executive. Rather, what we've seen to date are a number of attempts to erode rural education services as a cost-saving exercise, pretending to put children's interests first, while in reality, behind the scenes, it's a cost-saving exercise. At a moment. Mr Speaker, I would like to mention the impact rural school closures will have on local communities, as I know there is a devastating effect on my own community. Rural schools are very much part of the fabric of these communities, not only in providing education, but also jobs and consumerism. Removing schools will very much have wider implications on the local economy, and transferred redundancies will not resolve this. Give way to the member.
Giving way. Would the member clarify for the House what he deems to be the number that would be sustainable in terms of a rural school, given the fact that CCMS has stated in the past that 84 would be a figure that could be used, which would be a four-teacher school? Does the member agree with that, and is that what he would define in terms of a rural school?
The member has an extra minute.
As it has already been stated here today, each school should be determined on its own merits, and obviously to take a rural school out of any area is taking the heart out of any community. Mr Speaker, there are also significant issues concerning secondary schools and sixth forms which are outside today's immediate debate, but these are issues that are equally as important. To conclude my remarks, the Education Authority's backdoor plan to close rural schools is not based on inadequate education provision or poor financial mismanagement. It's a cost-saving exercise that yet again plans to erode vital local services. I urge support for the motion. Thank you, Mr Speaker.
I call Carla Lockhart.
Thank you, Mr Deputy Speaker. I'm grateful to be able to participate in this debate today. As a party, we want to provide sustainable and high-quality education for all children and young people in Northern Ireland, regardless of background, social mobility or location. To see a fair and equitable offering that gives children the very best start in life and one that will enable them to fulfil their full potential. Having been educated in a smaller school setting in rural Tyrone, just along the border area, I know all too well the importance of rural proofing and the need for protecting and investing in services that for many years suffered as a result of the Troubles. My primary school was particularly small, with my class of seven being one of the biggest, and I moved on to a post-primary school which was also small in size. So I know all too well the needs of rural areas and the need for area-based planning to take into account the specifics of an area and not just to look at the cold, hard figures. I stand in the House today to commend the Minister's systematic and empathetic way that he has approached this matter to date. And I have no doubt that going forward, that whilst he will not shirk his overall responsibility, he will do what is best by the school estate and ensuring that children have a sustainable and high-quality education service. There is no doubt that a rural school education is unique within a small school setting. Both the educational and pastoral care is exemplary, and I personally have benefited from this offering. However, with its benefits also comes some disadvantages and some challenges, both for the children and the dedicated teaching staff. There is no doubt that problems do exist in smaller schools, with sometimes the lack of breadth in their offer, be it curriculum for the formal offering or the extended offering. They sometimes do have difficulty in attracting and retaining staff to leadership positions, and sometimes existing staff having to fulfil several roles sometimes deters them from actually developing specialisms in particular areas. So, whilst yes, we have to look at the overall picture, I think it's important that we do so not through rose-tinted glasses and say, look, it's the children we're putting first here, and it's actually their education that we're putting first. We are all responsible politicians, well, most of us, and therefore we all know from our life experience that not everything can stay the same. We must shape a new school estate that meets the needs of the area in which it operates, and to ensure that the children it serves achieve an improved educational equality and experience for all its users. I welcome the Programme for Government's commitment to our children, and to that end, I am utterly confident that the Minister will ensure there is an improvement in educational outcomes, there is a reduction in educational inequality, and improvement in the quality of education provided. There is no doubt that empty school places, the surplus capacity, is having a detrimental impact on our overall budget for schools, and therefore it is imperative that a rationalisation of the school estate happens. We are all too aware that it... Absolutely.
Will the member agree with me that the figures on empty school desks needs to be reanalysed, that the schools that were built 30 or 40 years ago do not necessarily have the same amount of empty school desks now as they would have had then, and that so whenever we base decisions on figures such as that, really that should be looked upon first?
Yeah. Member's next minute.
I thank the member for her intervention. And yes, figures do need looked at, but I would also draw the member's attention to a meeting that we sat in just a number of hours ago in this House, or in one of the committee rooms, where we were told by principals that there was a problem, that there was a major problem in funding, and that empty school desks and spaces were at the heart of it and it needed to be addressed. So, you know, the member has to take responsibility whenever she brings forward notice of motions like this and not use our school and our children as a political football, which is happening in this place today. We're all aware that it is the responsibility of the Education Authority to liaise with the sectoral representatives, and I believe this will be a vitally important component of a comprehensive plan that meets the needs of the specific area. I know that within my own constituency there is a very clear model of how not to bring forward an area plan, and I only have to think back to the mess that was made around the Dixon plan, where there was a plan brought forward that wasn't transparent and that there was no consultation with communities. And yeah, the member makes a point in terms of who supported it. But what I would say is that has given us a basis to work from. There must be community consultation with parents, because we are a party that is fundamentally wedded to parental choice and ensuring that parental choice is adhered to. I firmly believe that with a change in strategic leadership and a minister committed to parental choice, there is an opportunity to really ensure that our estate is fit for purpose in the 21st century. It may, in some instances, cause pain and anguish, but for the long-term sustainability, it is vital that we work together to ensure the best possible outcomes for Northern Ireland.
Catherine Seeley. I now call Catherine Seeley.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. As my party colleague Barry McElduff has outlined, we will be opposing the original motion and voting in favour of the motion as amended by the DUP. I do accept, as is detailed within the draft plan, that the nature of the North's education system with its range of school management types means that in proportion to the number of children and young people to be provided with school places, there is a higher number of individual schools than would be the case elsewhere. An area plan should be welcomed, and in fact I do welcome the vision as outlined in the document, but I also appreciate why some are cautious. In an area as small as the North, we need to make decisions based on a vision of the whole of the North and in the interests of our young people and the quality of education they receive. Any such vision must also have input from pupils, parents, teachers and principals, as well as what has been suggested in the document, the managing authorities and sectoral support bodies. But most importantly, decisions must not be economically driven, but rather pupil-centred. Concerns regarding small rural schools should therefore be listened to and taken on board. I personally would caution against any correlation between school size and educational attainment. We must also acknowledge that small schools exist because bigger schools are simply too far away. I do, however, welcome the DUP amendment, which calls for the Minister to bring forward a strategic small schools initiative, evidence that this Minister is not only listening to concerns raised since the publication of the report, but also responding. I will give way.
Well, the member acknowledged that in May 2013, Sinn Féin actually voted in favour of a statutory presumption against rural school closures, and she's flip-flopping on that now.
I thank the member for her intervention. And what I would say to the member is that the ministers that we have had in the past, including the most recent John O'Dowd, made decisions based on pupils, made decisions based on their attainment and the value of education that they receive, and I'm confident of that. I want to note in particular the vision outlined for the ABC Council area, which I represent, which includes a commitment to establishing additional learning support and autism-specific provision within primary and post-primary schools, although I think this also requires us to incorporate SEN and autism-specific training into teacher training courses. There is also a commitment to provide further opportunities for children and young people to learn in specialist settings attached to mainstream schools, and I would welcome that. I think that would further the wholesome development of those children with additional educational needs as well as their peers. The document also commits to ensuring equitable access to the entitlement framework pathways so as all our students have access to a wide curriculum. This will undoubtedly help keep our young people engaged in education for as long as possible. Whilst the area plan does mention it will inform and shape education provision in primary, post-primary, special schools and learning support units in mainstream settings, it fails to mention EOTIS and juvenile centres, and I think this is a failing of the report. 33 EOTIS centres, for example, currently exist, providing education for over 600 pupils. Their experience of education should also be included in any vision moving forward. I want to give a specific mention to SEN provision across the North. It is absolutely vital that we reinstate full-time provision for all children, and in order to do just that, we have to, and as the draft plan states, improve the geographical accessibility to special educational needs provision and provide for projected growth in special educational needs support. Data indicates that a pressure of 143 plus additional special school places will be required over the next 3 years, so we must plan for this. Children with additional educational needs should enjoy the same full-time provision those who have no special or additional needs enjoy. Finally, over 69% of schools make provision for preschool children. Let's work to get that figure to 100%. Post-primary provision is offered in 87% of special schools. However, a number of these do not make 16-plus provision. That is simply not good enough. The final plan must also address this. In conclusion, Mr. Deputy Speaker, I welcome the draft plan, but hope the Minister takes into consideration the areas for improvement. And I would urge that all decisions are based on the needs of our children and young people and not the elasticity of the purse strings. Thank you.
I call Rosemary Barton.
Thank you. I have some very serious concerns, Mr. Deputy Speaker, about this draft area plan, particularly in the context of the area plan processes. As my colleague Sandra Overend stated, the Public Accounts Committee have had concerns also. In the Public Accounts report published, it stated that following that there was too much focus on three quantitative criteria. For the assessment of sustainability, the process of addressing surplus spaces under the plan did not meet its aims, and the reliability of the data presented in the Sustainable Schools Policy was called into question. The committee actually stated that the evidence based supporting the Sustainable Schools Policy falls far short of the acceptable standards that the department is basing decisions about the future of schools on inaccurate information. Despite the reduction in the number of surplus places, the long tail of underachievement has not in fact improved at all, and that engagement with key stakeholders around area planning was poor. Now, however, the Minister assures us that in fact this time things will be different, that everyone is now around the table. However, the truth of the matter is that the Minister can give no guarantees. With this all in mind, Mr Deputy Speaker, I am extremely concerned and baffled that the Minister has taken the decision to take this old, discredited proposal and try and pass it off to this House as if it were a new and improved idea. If the Minister had been serious about a credible, functional, strategic area plan, he would have started fresh with a new sustainable schools policy and a new area plan that would meet the needs of children and communities. A plan that could really address the issue of underachievement, a plan that would look at inequalities in our system, a plan that would take a more holistic view of our education system, instead of applying blunt instruments such as a school's financial position or its enrolment trends. Yes.
I thank the member for giving way. Given the member's long history in teaching herself, would she not agree that the pupil-teacher ratio is quite important around budgeting? And would she not agree that if we were to address that and reduce it, that it would actually leave more money for extracurricular activities and more tackling educational attainment?
Member's next or minute.
I believe pupil-teacher ratio is most relevant in the teaching of our children in the classroom. Certainly, after-curricular activities is important, but very often schools bring in grants in relation to that to assist with those. Indeed, in recent years, we have seen many schools able to turn stats around, like those as in Movilla High School, where enrolment was suffering and outcomes falling. Now they have gained their best GCSE results in years, and enrolment is on the up. With help and support, this could be facilitated in many schools across Northern Ireland. What other options has the Minister looked at? We live in the 21st century, and there are lots of examples across the globe where the use of technology has transformed teaching and learning in rural and more remote areas. Has the Minister considered that? Of course, this would require our executive to actually address the issue of broadband connectivity in Northern Ireland, what we spoke about earlier, of course. What about actually taking serious measures to address the school funding crisis by allowing schools to have better control over their own budgets?
Thank the member for giving way. The member may not be aware of this, but a couple of weeks ago I wrote out to every school in Northern Ireland asking them what greater level of autonomy they would desire, asking for their views of what bureaucratic burdens are placed upon them, with an idea of essentially saying, what do you want, so that actually that greater level of autonomy. So the member may be a little bit behind the times in terms of what's already happening in relation to this.
I await those answers. Thank you.
Would the member give way on that issue? I'm certainly aware that the schools have been written to in that respect, Minister, but I've heard the stories from schools saying the letter was very vague, and that they need detail on certain proposals. And yes, well, I think the answers are not there.
Okay, this matter in schools' budgets indeed is something schools have been calling for years. Indeed, the overall investment in our education system is embarrassing. Of all the four nations of the United Kingdom, Northern Ireland spends the least per head on primary and pre-primary level education. We must seriously think about investing more in our young people and their future. Adequately and strategically supporting education will have benefits across the board. Improving the health and well-being of our future population, supporting the prosperity and economic growth of our country, the strength of both rural and urban areas, and the list goes on. The current plan proposed by the executive of school closures and disinvestment will be disastrous for our young people. I ask you to join me in making a real start in addressing this crisis and support this motion as it is. This face-saving amendment from the DUP essentially allows our minister to get away with doing nothing. We cannot
Members,
support this.
Time's up. Agus Nish, Éireann Sir Jennifer McCann.
Deputy Speaker, could you provide clarity as to the role of officials and special advisers in a box during a debate? Are they there to support the minister in his role or government members in their interventions?
Perhaps you could provide some more detail to the Speaker's office around that for clarity on that, because I'm not entirely sure from here what it is you're referring to, but I presume you will provide that detail to the Speaker's office to seek further clarity on it. Thank you. Agus Nish, Éireann Sir Jennifer McCann. I call Jennifer McCann.
Mr. Deputy Speaker, I just want to begin by echoing my two colleagues and saying that we will be opposing the original motion and supporting the DUP amendment. Just reading over the draft area plan, I want to welcome some of the points that the general direction of travel, I suppose, in the plan, in that it puts the needs of children and young people at the heart of the planning process. And you know, it is also asked that it's suggesting that it wants a broad and balanced curriculum for all our children. And I think that given the number of debates that we've had, particularly over the past couple of weeks on education here, I think that it's really, really key that all of our children and young people have as much choice as possible in terms of the curriculum, and not just about academic subjects, while they're very, very important as well. I think, and we've discussed this as well, vocational subjects as well need to be part of that, and actually skilling up our children and young people for life and the, you know, the life skills that they'll need, because it's not just about, you know, as I said, academic an achievement. It is also about, you know, enabling, giving them the skills to deal with the life's problems and the life's difficulties that they meet in later life as well. I also want to acknowledge that it seeks to close the attainment gap, as this is an issue which should be of great concern to all of us here and even in the wider community. There's a very clear evidence, and we've heard it time and time again in these debates, and no doubt we'll hear it in the next debate again, which links deprivation, poverty and exclusion to underachievement and poor educational outcomes, and they act as a barrier to learning for some of our children and young people, and that really is something that we need to change. It's very important that we ensure that those young people, because of maybe the social and economic deprivation or poverty that they're born into for whatever reason, that they get the support that they need, because they are entitled. They're entitled to as much help and support as any other child, no matter what type of family background they come from. And I want to just say again, because we have had this again in debates here, but the excellent results in my own constituency of West Belfast in terms of, you know, the educational outcomes, which clearly shows when the right intervention is made in those areas that those children shine and the potential comes through. Every child has a right to have their potential fulfilled. And I believe that those interventions and those programmes of support actually help to do that. My colleague Barry McElduff mentioned about the need for another post-primary Irish medium, and particularly in North Belfast. and the North West. I think that that's a crucial thing because more and more people are learning through the medium of Irish. And I think that, that again, that's an important issue. I want to just also touch on the EOTIS provision, which isn't really, in my opinion, given the recognition it deserves in this, and I would hope in the final area plan that it would be. I have seen it firsthand, programmes like New Start in West Belfast that have actually, you know, with children, for whatever reason, mainstream education, and we all want the children to go to mainstream education, but for whatever reason, mainstream education just doesn't suit their needs. It just doesn't do it for them. And therefore, projects like that, programmes like that, that again, interventionist programmes where they have one-to-one support and they have the whole family sort of supported in those programmes. It's clearly the right way for some of those children to have those opportunities in life that other children have. So I want to just say that I hope that, the final plan would actually do that. I just want to also say, and the Minister would be aware, I know it's not about buildings, and I know the previous Minister, John O'Dowd, did excellent work in terms of the entitlement framework and bringing that forward. And it's not just about school buildings, but school buildings sometimes can be crucial as well, particularly when it is in an area where, for instance, you know, they don't have the sporting facilities in a school. And the Minister would be aware in the campaign in the Collin area of West Belfast for the new school for that area, you know, that it's essential that all our children, again, have access to those opportunities. And I think that it's about building a community as well. It's not just about a school. So I think with those regeneration projects are being taken forward, I think, again, I would like to see in the overall plan. And as I said, we've debated all sorts of things here over this past number of weeks. Nurture units, we've debated that. We've debated autism provision.
Would the member draw remarks
just,
to a close,
again, just
please.
To say that we will be supporting the amendment from the DUP, but not the original motion. Thank you.
I now call the Minister for Education to respond.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. Perhaps I find myself in the unusual position, following on from the last speaker. It's quite often in this House that whenever we have new members, there's a maiden speech that has to be dealt with, I suppose. I don't know if that's a valedictory speech on behalf of the member opposite. And while I know that I met the member recently in terms of the issues around Collin, obviously I'm not going to deal directly in this. It would be inappropriate for me to deal with individual schools, although I wait perhaps to see an imaginative proposal from Mr. McPhillips, who will maybe be having a merger between Brolla and Helsinki in the future. So the limits of imagination are not constrained within this House. Can I perhaps start with a note of consensus? There is at least, and I might even come down to a second item later on, there's at least one item that I do agree with the proposer of this motion. And I think relatively early on in her speech she said, and I hope I quote her correctly, "I do not understand." I agree with her, she clearly doesn't understand. Most obviously shown, I think, by her intervention in terms of autonomy, in which she complained that I had written to schools asking for their views on autonomy, and then complained that it was vague because it didn't tell them what autonomy they should be getting. Now, if members don't see the irony in that, then perhaps it's no wonder that this motion has gone so astray. I have to say, whenever the process in terms of area planning, and it should be made clear, and to be fair to the SDLP, they did actually refer to this correctly, in terms of the area, the education authority plan rather than department plan. But whenever I made a statement on the House on this, I made an appeal across the board, and it is clear that some have embraced this, that we need to look at this in a mature fashion. We need to ensure, indeed, that there will be, yes, there will be some tough decisions. There will be something which is painful. But in the same way, I think, as there's been a degree of embracing around Bengoa and a realisation amongst the vast majority of the Chamber that there is a wider strategic direction which needs to be taken. I think it is the same with area planning. Yet, therefore, it's very disappointing that mature response has not been met by the proposers of this motion. They have rushed before even conclusion in terms of the draft area plan has actually finished its consultation to prejudge it, to talk about a raft of closures, and indeed to put up the stockade as regards the status quo. It has also been characterised by a degree of scaremongering, which pretends that every rural school is simply going to close, that indeed there are not opportunities that are going to be there for new ideas and new thinking as regards that. And indeed, mention has been made about panic, and I'm sure there is, as we acknowledge, there is concern. But it has to be said in terms of concern, there are some that are trying to deal with this maturely, and some who are trying to fuel concern, fuel panic, increase scaremongering. And the movers of this motion, I think, seem to be falling into that category. Mention, I think, has been made about the missed opportunities of the past in terms of area planning. There is condemnation in the first line of this proposal about the failure to grasp area planning in an effective manner in the previous mandate. And there is some valid criticism within there. Now, lessons have been learned from that, and we're now in a situation that, in terms of area planning, a representative of every sector is around the table. But I think it ill behoves those who will actually criticise failures of area planning in the past, that when there is an opportunity for all of us afresh to actually have area planning in which everyone is involved, and particularly those from the community, with a completely open consultation, immediately steps are taken to try and scupper this. Now, a number of speakers, I think particularly the proposer of the Alliance motion, put it very succinctly, this should be about pupils rather than school buildings. The school estate should be there to service the needs of pupils, not the other way around. And that is what seems to be missing from the proposers of this motion. I would accuse them of wanting to put protection around every school in Northern Ireland so that the school's estate doesn't change. To be fair to them, that is not the position that they have taken. They want to have separate legislative protection for all rural schools. But if this is deemed something to be necessary to provide a degree of protection, where is the level of protection for any schools that fall outside the rural areas? If you're a pupil in Belfast, in Londonderry, in Portadown, in Ballymena or Macrofelt, the Ulster Unionists and the SDLP are happy on their own terms to simply abandon you. You can actually operate to a different sphere from what is there in terms of rural schools. Now, mention has been made about the No, I have to say I've heard enough from you today in relation to that on it. So, you know, I think you've given enough rope. I don't really want to give you any more in connection with that. Can I say in relation to this, there has been at times a range of selective quotations, and indeed, whenever we are looking at the criteria which has been put in, criticism has been made of the Sustainable Schools Policy, and I'd mention, I will come to the later on in terms of the amendments. The six criteria in assessing schools' viability is quality educational experience, stable enrolment trends, sound financial position, strong leadership and management, accessibility, and strong links with the community. Now, I would simply pose a question, which one of those six do they believe is no longer relevant? Because it is clear that that is a wider bit, and it is wider than simply the level of numbers through the door, or indeed the financial position. There is, in terms of the rural position, we have rural proofing within every policy that is within the executive, indeed with this House, and indeed the protections. Mention was made about what we should be seeking, and again, it's one thing at least I will agree with, that we should be looking at a degree of balance. And indeed, taking those in terms of any development proposal in a wider context of what are sustainable schools is that level of balance. But it is also the case that the status quo, there are problems with the status quo in terms of the school estate. That is why, and it has been accepted, and indeed I haven't heard any particular objections to this, that over the last 10 years, for instance, in net terms, there's about 100 schools have actually disappeared from Northern Ireland because there's been an acceptance that there's got to be something done about the school's estate. Now, mention has been made because this is both, in terms of the case for change, is both educational and also linked in with that is financial. And from a financial point of view, you can't get away from the educational side of it as well. Mention has been made of the inspectorate report and indeed evidence, and I appreciate it, I think it was too late to give a direct response to the chair of the committee, Mr. Michael Duff, in relation to that. But again, to quote from it, larger schools tending to do better inspections than smaller schools, and for primary schools, the specific difference that was highlighted, where it becomes meaningful, is where we actually move on the question of sustainability. Similarly, it also made reference that particularly whenever composite classes span more than 2 years, ensuring adequate progression in learning and planning becomes more of a challenge, that it limits opportunities for children to develop socially and emotionally. And I suppose while the focus has principally been on primary schools, again, there's a small but significant difference when you talk about in post-primary with schools that are above 500 in larger schools than on smaller schools. There is a clear indication. And indeed, the specific figures within that are in terms of the smaller you go down, that whenever you move, for instance, at the level in terms of below 105, there is a statistically significant difference in terms of inspection outcomes. It becomes more pronounced the smaller you go down the scale. And indeed, you know, whether you go to 85, whether you go to 60, that has an educational impact. We cannot pretend that that is the case. Now, there is no doubt there are some excellent teachers out there. There are some excellent principals in excellent schools delivering excellent results for their children. And that is why the Sustainable Schools Policy goes beyond simply a numbers game. It goes to the quality of it. But there is no doubt that when we move to very small schools, it is making it much more difficult for some of our pupils. There is also, and I cannot deny there is a financial aspect to this, for example, in terms of primary schools, teaching, for instance, the cost per pupil, where it is a school with less than 50, compared with a school over 100, the cost per pupil increases by more than 50% whenever you get to that level. Now, this is not an issue in which finance is simply driving that, although we do spend £27 million, the results in terms of that, £27 million directly on Small Schools Initiative, another £8 million in terms of principal release. But there is an economic aspect to this, and the economic aspect is this is not a question of storing up money to be taken out of schools. It is about the redistribution of money. It is actually about ensuring that, for example, where there isn't a need for schools, that we can get transferred redundancies to ensure that those teachers who want to go, but we actually then teach our children more effectively and efficiently. And therefore, it is about ploughing that resource into the remaining schools. So, you know, whereas there's a financial aspect to this, it's a financial aspect that we are giving too little in terms of the system to the schools that are out there. And we need to actually ensure that we get the best possible delivery for that. Mention has been made, I think, particularly by the proposers of the Alliance motion about, and others about process. And what will be the case, both in terms of the current consultation that is taking place in the draft area plan, then as we move towards annual area plans, indeed towards individual development proposals, that is something which a process is open to everyone. And I would encourage everyone to contribute to that. It is also particularly that the focus should be on the needs and desires of the community, but also in particular in terms of the pupils. Now, if I turn finally, I suppose, to the two amendments that are before us, I would indicate, obviously, they're mutually exclusive. I'll be supporting the DUP amendment. However, we clearly acknowledge that I think for the bulk of what was said by the proposer of the Alliance amendment, I don't have a particular problem with the Alliance amendment. I think it is a much more realistic position than the motion. But I will accept that there does need to be sensitivity within this. There will be concerns out there, which is why and I mentioned this whenever the sort of area plan was mentioned within the Assembly on the first occasion whenever I was making the statement on this. There will be a need to ensure that isolated communities out there are not simply left that they are too far away from a school. Mention was made, I think, by the proposer of the motion. She doesn't want to see children driving over an hour or getting in cars over an hour to go to school. And I think that there is a recognition that there's got to be some practical limitations in terms of distance as well. And as such, I am very happy to accept the amendment on behalf of my colleagues. It is something that I alluded to previously. There will need to be some degree of protection to ensure that the isolated schools, the most obvious example I think has already been highlighted in terms of Rathlin Island. Again, as with some other members, it's an area I know well as well, which, with the best will in the world, whatever the mechanics, yes, I'm happy to give way.
Thank you, Minister, for giving way. I accept his support for the DUP amendment today. Would he accept the important addition that proper, efficient and effective consultation with local rural communities will be an important addition to this process?
I'm happy to give that assurance. Obviously, as the member knows, that I suppose, unlike other settings, we can't simply amend on the hoof, but I think it is important that there is that level of proper consultation. But I would say that above all, you know, the status quo is one that does need to change. It needs to change above all, both from the financial point of view, but the educational point of view, because the key driver in all of this, and we can ensure that there are sensitivities, we can ensure that there are consultation takes place, but the key driver in all of this are the needs of our pupils moving forward, and we should be looking to protect the educational interests of pupils, not the educational interests of school buildings. And that is where the distinction that I will draw between the amendment that has been put before us and the failings, I believe, of the original motion. Thank you.
I call Chris Little to wind on amendment number two.
Thank you, Deputy Speaker. I welcome the opportunity to speak on this motion, and I thank my colleague Kelly Armstrong for putting forward the Alliance Party amendment today. I think it's important that we consider the context in which we set ourselves today and that we listen to educators. We're hearing from school principals across Northern Ireland that there is a financial crisis facing our schools. Our education committee has heard from one principal who has said that in 30 years of teaching, he has never known teacher morale to be so low. We have heard that the addition of superannuation costs and national insurance costs to school budgets were a straw that broke a rather large camel's back. We have also heard that the only remaining reductions many schools can now make is to staff levels and staff hours, and that there are some schools in Northern Ireland facing hundreds of thousands of pounds of deficits within the next 3 years. That, Deputy Speaker, impacts on the provision for children with special educational needs. It impacts on families, and it impacts on the educational outcomes we can achieve for children in our society. Principals in Northern Ireland also have concerns about the common funding formula, the use of free school meals as a criteria to assess both social and educational need, and a concern that investment is not focused on early years rather than post-primary. But every principal and teacher that we talk to emphasises that at the forefront of their concerns is not buildings or staff, but the outcomes that we achieve for children and how we as an executive and assembly are going to lead change to see the necessary reform to address these significant challenges. Ultimately, Deputy Speaker, the major concern being raised by teachers themselves with our party is, and with the Education Committee, is the elephant in the room that we have too many schools, too many unfilled places, and an unwieldy and ineffective administration. They clearly want to see whole-scale systemic reform, and that is undoubtedly going to need courageous political leadership and bold cross-sectoral area planning if we are to achieve those aims. But perhaps most importantly, and has been put forward capably by my colleague Kelly Armstrong, MLA, today, that is going to need robust, inclusive community consultation and engagement if we are to bring communities along with us on that change process. We, as a party, Mr. or Deputy Speaker, don't believe that we do need to see statutory schools protected. There will, of course, be schools, and in particular rural schools, that do need protection, but we can consider that on a case-by-case basis. My colleague Kelly Armstrong has set out the unique example of Rathlin Island, but there are some small towns in Northern Ireland with as many as three different primary schools. There are good examples of learning area groups coming together to maximise resources through collaboration, but the question and the key question remains, Deputy Speaker, if we don't rationalise and reform our education system, what else are we going to ask our schools to cut from our children's education? I don't think there's any avoiding the fact, Deputy Speaker, that tough decisions that will be difficult for political parties and local elected representatives to support will have to be made if we are to ensure that all children in our community have access to quality education in a sustainable school. Therefore, we are going to need much more responsible political leadership than we are used to in the past for the greater good of everyone in this society. Thank you.
I call Philip Logan to wind on amendment number one.
Thank you, Deputy Speaker. The Minister has spoken very well on our amendment, and it is clear to me that the Ulster Unionist Party do not understand the strategic draft strategic area plan. There's one thing that I can't get over about their motion, is that it doesn't mention pupils. It doesn't mention what's best for them. It reeks of all the luxuries of being unaccountable and not having to bear any responsibility. I wish to address our amendment first. Schools are not closed for absolutely no reason. The purpose of the area planning process is to implement the Department's Sustainable Schools Policy. The primary objective of the Sustainable Schools Policy is to ensure that all children get a first-class education in fit-for-purpose facilities, regardless of background or where they live, and make the best use of resources available for their education. It places the need... happy to give way?
The member agreed that in the Sustainable Schools Policy, rural schools are defined as all schools outside of Belfast and Londonderry, and so the nonsense that the Minister referred to earlier, talking about schools closing in Muckerfelt and Uri and elsewhere, is also a nonsense.
Look, certainly
the member has an extra minute.
Thank you, Mr Speaker. Certainly in regard to rural schools, you know, there's no separation when it comes to dividing money. These schools are a rural school and they're as important as an urban school. And yes, happy to give way to the Minister.
Thank you. In relation to the definition of rural, there are two definitions of rural. There's the specific definition in terms of what will be sustainable schools. However, this makes a general reference to rural and indeed rural within the Northern Ireland Executive, indeed the Assembly, but defines actually rural areas as below settlements below 5,000 in relation to that. So there is relevance because it's not actually specifically purely tied in with the sustainable schools, but goes wider in terms of protection in rural.
Okay. The sustainable schools policy places the needs of our children and young people at the heart of the planning process. Area planning aims to ensure children and young people have access to educational pathways and a broad and balanced curriculum that meets their needs. It is not focused on achieving a projected level of savings, but rather focuses on maximising the impact of available resources by working towards a network of schools that are educationally and financially viable. The criteria and their associated indicators are not used in robotic fashion to close schools. However, concerns about a school's viability are often addressed when enrolments have fallen to an irreversible level. In such cases, the criteria provide a framework for early identification of emerging problems and early identification so possible remedial action may be taken. The annual area profiles published by the Education Authority are based on three of the criteria and enable managing authorities to keep schools where in danger of becoming unsustainable under review. This topic is an emotive one, and there are many stakeholders, as Lord Morrow pointed out, there are many stakeholders involved in a school, pupils, parents, teachers and support staff. Schools, when faced with the prospect of potential closing, are protective and passionate, and rightly so. But schools, I need to make my point, I need to get on. But schools are not closed lightly or without consultation. Instead of putting in protections for rural schools just because they are rural, I believe there should be a case-by-case approach, and we've mentioned Rathlin, and rightly so. A school has to deliver for its pupils, regardless of the size, regardless of the location, and that is why we need a strategy so that small schools can help that can be helped to deliver. Smaller schools are facing challenges, but with a pragmatic approach and innovative and creative thinking, it is possible to ensure that education provision is available as close to a pupil's home as possible. In regards to the motion itself, if the previous minister and his officials marched to the top of the hill and then retreated, I accept that that is a failure. But we in this party are determined to take in those tough decisions that need to be taken. And we acknowledge that burying our head in the sand is not a viable, is not a long-term option. In regards to the concerns over rural schools, the Rural Needs Act of 2016, which received royal assent on May of this year, has placed a duty on public authorities, including district councils, to have due regard to rural needs when developing, adopting and implementing policies. So the Department of Education have to meet legal obligations to give due regard to rural needs when reviewing the SSP and the area planning process. When being allocated funding, schools in urban areas are treated exactly the same as those with similar characteristics in rural areas. The Minister has stated that he recognises that funding is a significant issue, and for all schools that they face difficult choices and ongoing challenges to ensure that they live within their budgets. And we heard from the principals earlier on today, and it was a very, very helpful meeting, and highlighted some of the issues that we're trying to get across in our amendment. As Chris Little mentioned earlier on, the Minister has committed to examining the common funding. He wishes to examine the common funding scheme to ensure that it is fit for purpose and that the best possible support is given to all schools and that the maximum advantage is being derived from the monies allocated. Within the common funding scheme, small schools support funding seeks to reflect the needs of smaller schools in delivering the curriculum. The Education Department's Sustainable Schools Policy is the framework used for assessing the viability, and it is a key driver for the area planning process. The Sustainable Schools Policy was rural-proofed, and as the Education Authority's draft area plan is based on the policy, then we can be assured that it is rural-proofed. Let me be clear. What
ask
we have here is a sensible
to
approach to schools
remarks.
Estate and puts pupils first with an acceptance that isolated areas cannot be abandoned. And I also believe, in closing, Mr Speaker, there needs to be choice for parents. Thank you, Mr Speaker.
I call Mr Colin McGrath to conclude and wind up the debate on the substantive motion. The member has up to 10 minutes.
Thank you very much, Mr Speaker, and I rise to support our motion as presented today. And I suppose the most interesting element that I do want to take time to recognise is that everybody in this chamber has the interests of our children and young people at heart. That is something that has impressed me during this debate, and whilst we may differ in some of the ways that we want to work through that, we all start from that basis. And I also feel that whenever it comes to the amendments, the DUP amendment and our own motion are very, very similar. In fact, the times and time that I've read through it, really the only difference I can see is that ours is calling for a legislative grounds against the presumption of closure of rural schools, and that isn't there. There's a thorough case has been asked for in DUP, so I see very, very little difference. And I think the fact that we're all here today in this playing field, that we're all arguing in the same direction for our children, is good. Even some of the contributions from the sideline, we appreciate those as well. But we aren't actually against the need for area planning. We would question, though, the measure through which closures would be decided, as suggested in the consultation. Now, there are many different things that are referenced throughout the consultation as to what should be taken into consideration, but time and time again, the Education Authority make reference to numbers. They talk about levels as to which and when a school is sustainable. They even give us it in percentages. They tell us the numbers that they are, and that's what makes me nervous, because to me that means that a line has been drawn in the sand where they're saying that is the level at which we are going to be making our decisions. And it is from that basis that we have our greatest concern for those in the rural communities. Rather than simply identifying schools with enrolment levels deemed to be of concern and then the first step in addressing them to be to close the school, the attitude needs to be, how do we protect the schools from closure, with closure being the last resort, rather than enrolment levels here are low, let's just simply throw away the keys. And that's why I have to question the integrity of the Providing Pathways Area Planning document. And I do take issue with what seems to be an attempt to window dress some of the numbers in a way that makes them seem slightly worse than they are. And I'll give the example where it document attempts to highlight the numbers of schools that would face closure with low numbers. It begins by citing the number of schools, and then it jumps to citing the percentages of them that have less than the desired numbers. And it's a worry about the lack of openness and transparency there, because it makes it sound like it's a low percentage rather than giving us the exact figure in terms of the number of schools. And whenever you churn that through, it works out at roughly 300 rural schools and 174 urban schools that, under their definition of the figures in the document, would be less than what they want them to be. And that's where it starts to get a little bit worrying, because it's not just a handful of schools. We're not talking about one in each county here. We're talking about 300 rural schools that do not meet the numbers. And that is a very, very high figure. Now, we are not denying that problems exist and that they have to be addressed. We are simply saying that a more holistic view on how to deal with these problems should be considered, and we think that that would be that more holistic approach would be true area planning. I also think that the consultation is particularly weak. 12 questions completed by Survey Monkey style, and barely enough room for 200 words for a qualitative response, doesn't feel like you're getting a good and proper opportunity to be able to respond. Schools too are at the core of any community, and particularly in rural areas, communities are built around local schools. Schools connect people, they bring jobs to often remote areas, and they instill a sense of ownership and belonging to an area that families live in. I attended a small rural school, and during the 70s, just right at the very end of the 70s when I started it, it was threatened with closure due to having small numbers. Now, it was saved then, and now it is a vibrant, forward-thinking and modern school with over 135 pupils, and people are queuing up to attend that school. If it had simply been taken the numbers approach of the late 70s and early 80s, it would have been shut down and it wouldn't have been there. And right around that school has built a small community. It's used for community facilities, it's seen as a community resource, and it's part of that community's identity. If it was simply asked to look at numbers back in the late 70s and early 80s, it would be closed and it wouldn't be there. Indeed, a quality school is more than... Yeah, go on ahead.
Forgiving way. I agree with the member to an extent. Same thing happened to Springfield Primary School on the edge of North Belfast between North and West. When I first got elected to Belfast City Council in 2005, there were 72 pupils. There's now over 176. But would the member also agree with me that as well as providing a good school, it has to provide a good education and academically deliver for children? Is that not something which the member needs to draw attention to as well in his speech?
Yeah, I thank the member for his intervention, and I think we could take it as a given that we want the best educational outcome for all of our children in all of their schools. And closing them is not just necessarily the way that may result in a better education. Lumping schools together, merging them, having larger class sizes, that may not necessarily be the approach that needs to be taken. And I think that's the sort of substance of what our motion is here is saying today. It's saying that the presumption should be there that you don't close the schools. We're not saying that you don't. We're just saying that the presumption is there that you shouldn't close them, that you have to expel all other possible decisions and methods that could be taken to try and provide the education. So I think that's maybe where there's a bit of a difference between the interpretation. This isn't saying that you don't close. It's saying that the presumption is there that you don't close. And that's not just to be used in a way that you say that you presume that you aren't going to close them and then go off and close them. It's about saying that there needs to be a thorough process that you need to follow. And yes, certainly.
That would be the same presumption against rural closures that the DUP and Sinn Féin both voted in support of in May 2013.
I thank the member for her intervention. Her use of history is much better than mine, being here before. And it's always great to see how quick people can change their perspectives on matters whenever they're in different offices. But I hope that we can stick to the spirit of trying to give good educational outcomes for our children, and that a presumption against closure would certainly help that. In terms of, Mr. Speaker, the amendments that are there, I am a bit concerned because the DUP amendment was there. Just the word that I worry about is accessibility, and it's not really detailed anything further than that. Ensuring that there's accessibility to a good education, that accessibility could be accepted by saying that there's a school 20 miles, 25 or 30 miles down the road, and that there is where we're going to provide that education to you. That would be concerning because we don't feel that that's fair. That's not accessible to have to put children through lengthy journeys to and from school. No, I think we've heard enough from you today. Thank you. I think that was an answer that you used earlier. Now, no one is saying that a school should. No one is saying that a school should be available on every road or in every street. But simply covering up closures by using the term accessibility, we think, is a bit crass. Moving to the Alliance Amendment, there was the mention of the ETI's Chief Executive Report last week and how that could be considered in any decisions that are taken forward. And I think, to be fair to the Minister, that he actually would always consider the ETI reports. That's the purpose of them. They make their reports so that you can consider them in the ways whenever you're making your decisions in the future. So I don't think that we need to specifically provide some legislation for that. And also, it talks about how you need to consult and how you need to work with communities and how you need to actually assess with them whether or not a school should be closed. We feel that if you have a presumption against closure, that would be part of that process, consulting with the community, discussing with them, asking them their views, allowing them to be part of the process. And therefore, we feel that both of the suggestions that's in the Alliance motion would therefore be part of our own. We do present, Mr. Speaker, the motion today to stop a process of rural closures. We have heard some anecdotal soundings from within the department that want to see up to 300 closures. This would be disastrous for our community and especially for our rural communities, and especially if this is to be done simply by numbers. Introducing a legislative presumption to keep rural schools open would provide some comfort to teachers, parents and pupils that small schools won't automatically face the chop, and it's for that reason that I commend the motion to the House.
Members, before I put the question on Amendment number 1, I would remind members that if Amendment number 1 is made, I will not put the question on Amendment number 2. The question is that Amendment number 1, standing on the name of Lord Morrow, Mr Philip Logan and Ms Carla Lockhart, be made. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. Do we have teller? Sorry, to clear the lobbies, the question will be put in 3 minutes. Members resume their seats. The question is that Amendment number 1, standing in the name of Lord Morrow, Mr Philip Logan, Ms Carla Lockhart, be agreed. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no.
No.
Do we have tellers? Thank you. Order, order. Tellers have been appointed as follows. Tellers for the ayes are Adrian McQuillan and George Robinson. Tellers for the noes are Sandra Overend and Colin McGrath. Clear the lobbies. The Assembly will divide. Ayes to my right, noes to my left. Secure the doors. Secure the doors. Order. Ask members to resume their seats. I'll ask the clerk to read the result.
92 members voted, 66 members voted aye, 26 members voted no. The amendment is therefore agreed.
The amendment is agreed. I ask you to unfasten the doors. The question is that the motion as amended be agreed. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it.